According to the most recent surveys, 23% of all adults in the United States have not read a single book in any format in the last 12 months. And personally, I'm not at all surprised by this because reading isn't exactly easy on the human brain. And as I explained last week, our brains are hardwired by default to avoid doing things that appear to be difficult. Unlike spoken language, which comes naturally to most people, reading and writing don't come naturally to us. Instead, they take many years to be taught and practiced, then arguably reading and writing can never be perfected. I don't think I can overstate what an extraordinary achievement it was when our great ancestors finally figured out how to write stuff down, because it allows unadulterated knowledge to be passed down from one generation to the next. But it took us quite a while to get there. Our ancestors roamed the earth for hundreds of thousands of years before they finally created the first writing system, the cuneiform script in Mesopotamia in modern-day Iraq. That was only 5,200 years ago. In other words, we've only been reading and writing for a tiny fraction of our existence as a species. I did the maths and it works out to be around 2%, give or take. And while most people watching this video will be familiar with only languages that have a written form, it's helpful to remember that out of the 7,100 languages that people around the world still speak today, only 4,000 languages have a written, readable script. Reading and writing are clearly cultural inventions manufactured by humans, and not a consequence of either biology or nature. And here's why this matters. While there are distinct brain regions which are entirely dedicated to specific functions, for example, movement, speech, hearing, vision, memory, and so on, your brain lacks a dedicated brain region and lacks specific networks for reading. This means that your brain needs to borrow bits and pieces from different systems in the brain to turn random drawings on a page or a screen into recognizable words with meaning, and put these words together to understand a sentence in the context of the rest of the text that that sentence is in. My name is Hesham, and today I'll be telling you why you should plan to read more in 2022 and how reading boosts brain function and connectivity. Don't forget to subscribe and hit the bell icon for more weekly videos about the human brain and some practical advice on how you can grow and boost your brain function. If someone asked me to explain in just one word why the human brain was so freaking cool, I'll probably say neuroplasticity. Neuroplasticity describes the brain's ability to change, to reorganize or rewire itself, and be shaped by our immediate environment and the things that we do with it. Neuroplasticity enables us to change our behaviors and thinking, and without it, well, therapists everywhere would be out of a job. At the risk of sounding too philosophical, without neuroplasticity there can be no change and no second chances for us. Individuals become fixed and societies stay stagnate and galactic civilizations fall into 30,000 years of darkness. I'm sorry, I've just been reading Isaac Asimov's Foundation lately and clearly it's affecting my brain. Which kind of makes sense, because in 2013, a group of scientists performed functional MRIs on the brains of a group of volunteers. They performed these MRIs for a period of 5 days to measure baseline brain activity. The volunteers were told to read a chapter from Robert Harris's novel, Pompeii, every day for 9 days. They had their brain activity measured on each of those 9 days and for the following 5 days after they stopped reading the novel. And here's what the scientists found out. On the initiation of reading, there was a dramatic increase in brain activity in three distinct brain networks. The first network was concentrated around the left angular and the supramarginal gyri, and showed a dramatic increase on the first day of reading and continued to increase until reading was stopped, when it declined dramatically. The left angular gyrus plays an important role in attention, information, and emotional processing, as well as mentalizing. Mentalizing refers to the ability to reflect upon your own actions and the actions of other people, interpreting them. It's basically what someone means when they tell you that they're good at reading people, understanding their actions, motives, and beliefs. In short, reading more increases brain activity in regions that are associated with empathy. Meanwhile, networks 2 and 3 involve the posterior temporal gyrus and its connections with the cuneus and central sulcus, respectively. These networks are believed to play an important role in giving the random words on a page or a screen meaning, by first converting them into sounds or speech, and then converting these sounds into a picture in your head, allowing you to see the events that are happening in the story you are reading. Interestingly, some people appear to lack the ability to turn words into images in their heads, meaning that if you ask them to imagine a book or any other object, they won't be able to. They can identify it or point out to it, but they can't conjure an image of it in their minds. This condition is called aphantasia and may explain why some people find it difficult to enjoy novels or other works of fiction. Moreover, reading is a unique exercise because it requires you to access both your short-term and your long-term memory. First, you need your short-term memory, which typically lasts anywhere between 20 to 30 seconds, to make sense of the sentence that you're reading and not get lost mid-text. You must then make use of your long-term memory to retrieve information about the characters and the previous events in the story, giving the sentence you just read context. Reading really is a whole brain exercise, which is why if you'd like to read the full research papers that I used to make this video, you're more than welcome to. You should find the link in the description below to my free Substack newsletter, which contains all my references as well as a few fun extras. And while you're down there, please leave a comment below telling me what book you plan to read in 2022. You'll find my response there too. But the truth is, we actually read much more today than we did in any other time in our history. We're constantly checking social media, reading dumb stuff on Facebook, receiving and sending text messages, and those of us who are intellectually inclined might read a longish article on the New York Times, The Economist, or some scientific journal every now and then. But quantity doesn't equal quality. Reading is a cognitively demanding task, but it's not really demanding if what you're reading is a 140 character tweet by Donald J. Trump. For starters, novels and other works of fiction tend to be much longer than other forms of text that we might come across in our day-to-day life. This means that our brains need to be engaged for longer. You need to pay more attention, remember and imagine more things, and connect more deeply with the characters and the events of the story that you're reading. And works of fiction, at least good ones, tend to be subtle, something that most content on social media lacks today. And subtlety is so important, because it introduces variation in how we respond to a particular work, so that no two people will have the same reaction to the same piece of text. This is because our individual response to a particular piece of text will often be shaped by our culture, our past experiences, and even our unique biological makeup. I guess what I'm trying to say is that there is so much more that you can say about Andre Asiman's Call Me By Your Name, or Frank Herbert's Dune, which I just finished reading by the way, than you can say about Kanye West's latest Twitter mumblings. Which is why you should make 2022 the year that you read more. More books, that is. This video was kindly sponsored by none other than me. I'm happy to announce that, believe it or not, this YouTube channel actually now has its own fan token on the Polygon blockchain. In other words, we have crypto! It's worth absolutely nothing, but it's a small token of my gratitude and a small thank you for you guys for all your support. If you'd like me to send you some nerves, yes, that is the name that I chose to name the fan token, then share this video on Facebook, Twitter, or Reddit, and give this video a like. Make sure you have a Polygon wallet address, and I'll shortly send some nerves your way. I know this is silly, but who knows, maybe if this channel gets big in the future, the nerves that I send you will be worth something in the end. Like, maybe in a few years, you might be able to buy NFTs with them. NFTs off my face. But let's be honest, you probably don't want that. Maybe you do, though. Don't forget to subscribe and hit the bell icon, and see you all next week. And remember to do some reading until then.